Hello friends, this is my third lecture on the topic Fundamentals of Thermodynamics. So we will see what we have seen in the second lecture. In the previous lecture, we have seen these points, that is what is thermodynamic state, process and cycle. Next, we have seen what is quasi-static process along with its example. Then we have seen what are the path and point function. We have also seen their difference. Then the last point with which we concluded was thermodynamic equilibrium, that we have seen all the three types of thermodynamic equilibrium, that is mechanical, thermal and chemical equilibrium. So today we will start with the next point. So we will see what is the concept of work and heat. So if we start with work, then in simple words we know that what is the work. It is defined as the product of force and displacement. Here I will give you another definition for the work. In thermodynamics, work performed by a system is the energy transferred by the system to its surrounding. The work acting on the system or a work done by the system may have different sign conventions. So the work should be considered to be positive or negative. We will study that part when we are going to study the sign conventions for heat as well as work. So right now, just remember this definition, that work performed by the system is the energy transferred by the system to its surrounding. Mathematically, we can write work as the product of force and displacement. So in this formula, F is nothing but force and D is nothing but displacement. The unit of work is joule. Next we will see what is the concept of heat. So thermodynamic definition of heat. It is the energy in transition between the system and the surrounding by virtue of its temperature difference. Simply we can say that wherever there is temperature difference, we can see that there is transfer of energy. It is nothing but a form of energy, and it usually or it naturally transfers always from high temperature region to lower temperature region. This is what is given in this definition. It is the energy in transition between the system and surrounding due to its temperature difference. The SI unit for heat is joule. Since it is form of energy, the SI unit for this will be joule. The heat and work relation example, here if we see that we are going to study much more detail about the relation between heat and work while studying the laws of thermodynamics, but simply just I am giving here example. If we want to convert a heat into work, then we can see this example in case of a thermal power plant, where we are just burning some kind of fuel such as coal and then converting this heat into mechanical energy, or that is simply work. And the second example of relation between heat and work is nothing but refrigeration. In refrigeration, we can take consider the simple example of refrigerator or air conditioner, where we are supplying electrical energy, which is nothing but the work, and in return we are getting the cold effect from the devices. So this is the relation between heat and work. The thermal power plant will convert heat to work, whereas in case of a refrigeration, work will be converted into heat. So this was the concept of thermodynamic work and heat. Next part is the sign conventions. The sign conventions are very important. We should know when to take heat and work as positive or negative. So we will see this in this example or in this figure. Here in this figure we can see that the Q, this letter Q stands for heat, whereas this word W stands for work. If we consider this as a system, this circle, if we consider this as a system, then if the heat enters into the system, as shown here, heat is entering into the system, then we will consider that heat to be positive. Okay, then next, if the heat is leaving out of the system, then we will see consider it as to be negative. So heat entering into the system is positive, whereas the heat leaving out of the system is negative. If we consider about work, these two points are for work. So remembering the sign conventions for work, you can simply remember that the sign conventions for work will be exactly opposite to that what we have assumed in case of heat. So since the heat entering into the system, we are taking it as positive. Then similarly, if work is done on the system, then we will consider that work to be negative. Whereas if the work is done on the surrounding, then we will consider it as positive. So this is given here. I will again repeat the sign conventions. First, if we speak about the work, then work done by the system. That means this work is done by the system on the surrounding. So just you should understand what is the system and surrounding, which we have studied earlier. If we system is nothing but a thermodynamic consideration, a part of universe which is under thermodynamic consideration, and the all the area inside this circle, it is our system, and the part which is outside this circle is nothing but the surrounding. So if we see about this first point, that is work done by the system is positive, which means that this line, so this line indicates that work is done by the system on the surrounding, and we will consider that work to be as positive. The next is work done on the system is considered to be negative. So this indicates that is work, this W is nothing but the work done on the system. Okay, work is done on the system by the surrounding, and for this we will consider the sign convention, that is work, to be negative. Now that this third line has given, heat given to the system is positive, that is this one. If we are adding some heat into the system, then we will take it as positive, whereas if the heat is rejected by the system, then it is to be considered as negative. So here this heat is rejected by the system to the surrounding, and we are considering this heat to be negative. So this is all about the sign conventions for heat and work. Now we'll see what is the difference between heat and work. First we'll see here you can see the two columns. If we see the definition, then work is the amount of energy transferred by a force acting through a distance, whereas in case of heat, it is just a form of energy. We can also add that it is transferred by virtue of its temperature difference, and it will always flow from high temperature region to lower temperature region. Work is a path function, whereas heat is it is actually a function of a state. Next, there will be ordered motion in one direction in case of work, whereas in case of heat, there will be unordered motion, or we can say that there may be some random motion of molecules. Next, work can be totally converted into heat. This is the reason why we call work as it is a high grade form of energy, because 100% work we can convert into heat. Whereas in reverse case, this is not possible. That is, if we consider heat, then we cannot convert 100% heat into work. So heat is called as a low grade energy. A very important point for heat and work. Remember that this I will repeat once again. Heat is called as a high grade energy since it can be entirely converted into heat. Whereas heat is considered to be low grade energy since it cannot be converted 100% back into work. Next, a method of transferring energy. Work is it is actually a method of transferring energy, whereas heat itself is a form of energy. So this is all about the difference between heat and work. Now in the next part we will see what is the energy. Many times we should know what is the definition and its type, because it may be asked in paper. We will see what is the definition and its type. Energy is nothing but it is the ability to do work. A very simple definition for energy. We will see the types of energy. There are actually two types of energy. The first one is the kinetic energy. First we will see what is kinetic energy. Then we will see the other type of this energy. Kinetic energy It is nothing but energy possessed by body due to its motion. So wherever there is motion, we can relate it with kinetic energy. For example, we'll consider that a running car or flowing water, since these are examples which are in motion, we are considering that to be as kinetic energy. The formula for calculating kinetic energy is given here. Kinetic energy is nothing but half mv square, where m stands for mass of the object, whereas v stands for velocity of that object which is in motion. So this was all about kinetic energy. We will see some more examples for this. Here in this diagram we can see that if we consider this first figure here, the football which is kicked by the sports person, when this football is kicked, then it will have some motion. So this football is an example of kinetic energy. It will possess some kinetic energy. Another example, we can see here two cars. One car is moving with velocity 10 meter per second, whereas the other car is moving with velocity 30 meter per second. So both will have kinetic energy, but if we are comparing these two, then if we put this velocity value in this formula, then you can understand that the vehicle which is moving with 10 meter per second will have a lesser kinetic energy as compared to this car. This is because as per the relation or as per this formula, since mass of both the cars are assumed to be same due to its velocity, if we put that velocity in this formula, then we can get the value of kinetic energy. So more the value of velocity, then more will be the value of kinetic energy. So if we compare these both cars, then definitely this car or the car having 30 meter per second will have a higher kinetic energy. So these were the examples of kinetic energy. Next we will see what is potential energy. The other form of energy, that is potential energy. Energy possessed by body due to its rest position is called as potential energy. For example, a pen kept on a table or the water which is stored in a lake or dam, these are the examples of potential energy. The formula for potential energy is given as potential energy is equal to mgh, where m is nothing but mass of the object, g is acceleration due to gravity, and h is nothing but height in meters where the object is placed. So this is the concept of potential energy. We will see further examples for this. Now if we consider these two balls which are kept at different heights, first example, if we assume two balls having same mass as shown in this figure, these two balls having same mass but that having different heights, then we can calculate the potential energy for both these balls by using this formula. Potential energy is equal to mgh. Since both the balls are having same mass, acceleration due to gravity, that is g, will be also same, just the difference is height. So for the first ball, if we keep here h is equal to 1 meter and h is equal to 3 meter, then definitely we will get the potential energy of both the bodies. And for the second case, the potential energy will be higher than as compared to the first case. So the potential energy is dependent on the height. At what height the object is placed, higher the height, then greater will be the potential energy. Similarly, here also we have another example. We have here three balls with different colors, that is blue, red and green. Now I would like to ask which ball will be having higher potential energy. So the answer to this will be this red ball, because if we consider this reference line or datum, then from this line the red ball is at a greater height. So for this ball the potential energy will be much higher as compared to the other balls. So this was a concept related to potential energy. Now we will see one more example of potential energy. In this figure, we can see that the person is climbing on the inclined road. So when the person is climbing this inclined road, let's consider this picture, then he has to put more efforts to climb this road because he is traveling against the gravity. So when this person will reach at the top position, then at this position the potential energy will be maximum. As in the earlier slide we have studied that the potential energy is maximum if the height is maximum. So here in this case, here the potential energy will be maximum. Now again, when this process is occurring, that is the person is climbing on this inclined road, here we can see that during this travel the kinetic energy is converted into potential energy. Okay, now if this person wants to again climb down the road, then he do not have to put more efforts or extra energy. He can easily climb down this road. Why this happens? Because actually whatever the energy is invested during this travel while climbing up of this road, the same some energy is stored during this process, and when he is climbing down on this road, that time the stored potential energy is utilized, that is this potential energy will be converted into kinetic energy, and so this person can easily come down this road. So this was the example of potential energy along with kinetic energy. This was the concept of potential energy and kinetic energy. Now apart from these two main types, there is one more type of energy which we should study, that is internal energy. Internal energy, it is denoted by the letter U. We can define internal energy as follows. Internal energy for a system is the total energy for that system. So we have studied earlier what is potential energy and kinetic energy. We can generally say that internal energy is the summation of this potential energy and kinetic energy. Now why internal energy is important? We are interested in tracking this internal energy because it allows us to know whether the energy is coming inside the system or it is going outside the system. Also, we can understand that if there is change in internal energy, then there must be change of energy in between the system and surrounding. This energy flow is either in the form of heat or work. So we can write the internal energy mathematically as follows. Here we can see the equation delta U is equal to Q plus W. Delta U is nothing but change in internal energy, Q is nothing but heat, and W is nothing but work. So the sign conventions for this Q and W may vary depending on the given conditions of the system. The sign conventions for both, that is heat and work, we have already studied that. Then we have to take this as positive and negative as per the given condition of the system. So this was the concept of internal energy. Now let's see what is the concept of enthalpy. Enthalpy is denoted by H. We'll see first a definition of enthalpy. Enthalpy is defined as the sum of internal energy and the product of pressure and volume of a thermodynamic system. We can write this definition mathematically as follows, that is H is equal to U plus PV. Here H is the enthalpy, U is the internal energy, P is the pressure, and V is the volume of the given thermodynamic system. Apart from this definition, we can have one more simple definition for this enthalpy. So enthalpy can be defined as the total heat content of the system. So this is the simple definition of enthalpy. Now here students have confusion between heat and enthalpy, because while defining this simple definition of enthalpy, we can see that enthalpy is nothing but what heat is available in that system. So students are a little bit confused between the concept of heat and this concept of enthalpy, but these both points are totally different. Heat is actually a form of energy and it gets transferred by virtue of its temperature difference. It will not give any information related to work. However, in case of enthalpy, though we define it as total heat content of the system, but this term is used in thermodynamics to get information that how much amount of heat is available in the system to carry out some specific work. So for this work related activity, this term enthalpy is very important. In other words, we can say that whether that heat is sufficient to produce some kind of work. For example, in case of a thermal power plant, we are producing energy in boiler, or we can say that in boiler we are preparing some steam, and this pressurized steam is then provided to the turbine to produce work. So the turbine is the device which will be producing work, and for producing this work, the working fluid will be provided by the boiler. So if we want to study what amount of work will be developed, or to develop some kind of work in turbine, whatever the energy is required in that boiler, for that part enthalpy is very important. So enthalpy will give us information whether that boiler, how much amount of heat is supposed to be added to the boiler so that it can produce some work in the turbine. So for this purpose, enthalpy is very important. Now we'll study the concept of enthalpy with this diagram. In this diagram, we have one container which is filled with certain amount of gas. So when we are adding, if we are supplying some heat, as shown here, if we are providing some heat to this container, then we can see that there is some molecular activity inside this container. So whatever the heat is added to the system, that heat is first converted into internal energy. So in this formula, we can say that here heat, or whatever the heat we are adding, that is first converted into internal energy, that is this U part. Now in this second diagram, if we are further adding heat to that system, let us assume that we have placed one piston at the top of this container. Now then with further addition of heat, the gas particles or the gas molecules inside this container will start to expand. As a result, this piston will move in upward direction and there will be change in volume. So this change in volume is represented as delta V in this figure. So as the piston is moved by some distance, say we are representing as delta V, this change in volume is nothing but that some amount of work has been done by the system on this piston. So here we can see that work is obtained in this system. So we are adding this with internal energy, that is U plus PV. So I hope you understand this formula. H is equal to U will come from this diagram, and H is equal to PV, that is here first internal energy has been added, and apart from that internal energy, if we are adding further heat, then it will cause the displacement of this piston. So this gives us the product of pressure and volume. So the summation of all that internal energy and the product of pressure and volume will give us enthalpy. So I hope that the concept of enthalpy you have understood very well. In this case, in case of enthalpy, work is obtained, and this is the important part when we are studying enthalpy. So in conclusion, we can say that enthalpy gives information that whether the available heat in the system is sufficient to produce work or not. After enthalpy, today we will also see the concept of entropy. So the entropy is denoted by letter S. It is defined as: entropy is the measure of a system's thermal energy per unit temperature that is unavailable for doing useful work. In simple words, we can say that entropy is nothing but the energy which is not useful for producing work, or we can say that energy that is wasted. Apart from this, we also know that work is obtained from ordered molecular motion. So the amount of entropy is also a measure of molecular disorder or randomness of a system. From this we can understand that if the molecules in the system are perfectly aligned, then maximum or effective work can be obtained from that system. But if the molecules are scattered everywhere, then we are supposed to align those all molecules in particular direction to order or to obtain maximum work. But if the molecules are scattered everywhere, then we call it as randomness or molecular disorder. In such case, if the molecules are misaligned, then we will not obtain the effective work. In many thermodynamic applications, we measure entropy in the form of change in entropy, which is nothing but a change in entropy is equal to change in heat divided by its absolute temperature. So mathematically we can represent it as follows: delta S is equal to delta Q by T, where delta S is change in entropy, delta Q is change in heat, and T is nothing but absolute temperature. The unit of entropy is joule per Kelvin. Joule is for this unit of heat, whereas temperature unit is Kelvin. So unit of entropy will be joule per Kelvin. We will see the concept of entropy with the help of diagram. So as earlier we studied about order and disorder, we will see here what is the actual concept. So in this figure you can see this is the diagram for ice. So in case of ice, we will have a structure like this. So here in this figure we can observe that the molecules are perfectly arranged. So this we call it as ordered molecule. Whereas in case of water, if we consider water, then in that case we can see here that the molecules are scattered everywhere. They are having different directions. So we call it as disordered molecular motion. So this is difference between ordered molecular motion and disordered molecular motion. Again, we will have one more example. So in this figure, we can see that the particles are tightly packed with each other. So this is highly ordered. Whereas here, we can see that the same particles are scattered everywhere. So we call it as disorder. If we consider all the three phases, that is solid, liquid and gas, then entropy for all will be different. Like if we first consider solid, then in case of solid, there is no molecular disorder or randomness. Thus, the entropy for solid in this case will be very much less. However, for liquid, the entropy will slightly increase and it will be highest in case of gases. Since in gases, all the molecules are in a completely disorder or they are scattering everywhere. So in case of gases, the entropy will be maximum. One more example we can see here. This will be better to remember. If we consider ice, since ice is in solid form, here the entropy will be very much less. But if the same ice is converted into liquid, then for this liquid, we can see that the entropy for liquid will increase. So for ice, the entropy will be less, whereas for liquid, the entropy will be maximum, and in case of gases, the entropy will be highest. So this was the concept of entropy. We will conclude here today. In today's lecture, I have not given questions from MSBT, but definitely in the upcoming lecture, I am going to cover all the MSBT questions from today's lecture as well as previous. Thank you.